All right. The situation is really difficult right now, yeah, for some of us, isn't it? Certainly it is. And what I tried today is to go back to the what I've recommended before, which is I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And just repeat that over and over and over, and just stay on that for as long as you can. Well, I was just lying down. And it's amazing again. Amazing what you'll experience. The parade of impostures and the attempt to stop you from doing this. So what we need is a technique that we fall back on when things get really tough. A way that we're certain will work no matter what. It's like a drill drilling through a wall. You just keep drilling. No matter what all the distractions are, you just keep drilling. And so this is what I recommend. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This contains ultimate truth. And as if we keep insisting on ultimate truth, this is what evaporates the resistance. So, things are situation seems to be getting worse by the minute here, actually. And it gets to all of us. There's no question about it. It's really getting to me badly. But the thing is, don't focus on the negative of this world. Focus on the positive. Flip it, the script, to the positive of, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is a very positive thing to say. And just keep saying that. This may be the only thing we can really do at this point. The situation's gotten so tough. And it doesn't really help to explain the toughness, how bad it is, because that's putting your attention on all the negative, what undermines our the good news. It undermines what we're trying to do here. So again, please refrain from bringing in severe negativity to the practice. Your practice and others' practices, we're trying to keep it asserting the truth, which is all good, all positive. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And whatever arises, just keep saying that. I have, you'll see many tricks. One of them this today was something in my mind said, repeated. I said, I am not a body. I am free. And then they were like repeating along with me, and then say, oh, and they said, oh, okay, I got it. I got it. I think I got it. Okay. Now let me do it. Let me do it. I want to do it. And so then I stopped, and then this was my thoughts were repeating it. I said, no, wait a minute. I don't want to stop doing it. That's just a trick to get me to stop doing it, as if I'm training somebody to do this. No, I'm doing it myself. We don't want to lose touch with our basic tools here, and we want to make sure that we use them now. The three-part practice, assertion, stop, full stop in the wild, flipping the script, and the continuity practice, I do not have a distraction problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. The distraction problem doesn't exist for me. Only, therefore, it has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. You use that in support of your practice, and you use the root assertion, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So we have these like five tools right now, five really extremely helpful tools. I don't know what the next step is going to be. Everything feels very heavy right now. I had a dream last night where I was able to see in my mind some ideology that I've been clinging to, which is binding me. It's very much binding me. But this is good to see that in your mind. Actually, all problems are simply in the mind, and therefore there aren't real problems at all, because you can always change your mind at any moment. So they're more like fixations. That were fixated. And something great to share here with you. The breakthrough I had just before I started taping this, thank God I didn't slip my mind, is that in these videos, especially the one I did several videos ago, I don't remember the title. I never remember the titles, but in it, I said that reality, there's nothing that can be said about, I already know, there's absolutely nothing that can be said about reality. There's absolutely nothing that can ever be said about reality. Now, this kicked up a great deal of resistance within me, a great backlash, blowback, backlash. And it's been ongoing, and now I see why, that our defenses want to have something to defend against. And so our defenses insist on being able to label God, to find God. There has to be some thing, some time, space, process, and form involved with God in order to see, okay, what is it we're defending against? And if I say there's absolutely nothing that can ever be said about a reality, nothing whatsoever, we feel like we don't know what to defend against, how to defend against it, and it frightens us tremendously. So we insist on structuring God, God having some structure that we can then identify and defend against. So this is what's really kicking up so much resistance. Ever since I did that video, I've been really struggling with tremendous resistance. Yes, I already know there's absolutely nothing that can ever be said about reality. Yes, I already know there's absolutely nothing that can ever be said about reality. There's absolutely nothing that is ever relative to reality. There's nothing relative to reality. So there's nothing we can use as a symbol or something like reality to say, well, this is similar to reality, so we defend against this. Let us design our defenses against this. There's nothing that is relative to reality. There's nothing that symbolizes reality. There's absolutely nothing that we can ever say about reality. Nothing fits, nothing describes it, nothing defines it. Realize, I already know that reality is totally indefinable. Or undefinable. Yes, I already know that reality can never be defined in any way. Yes, I already know that reality can never be defined in any way. Now, the mental situation that we are in, we call it a world. We're just in a mental fabrication. We're in the mind, and the play of the mind right now is getting really nasty, and we may need to block it, actually. We may need to simply put a block on that aspect of the mind which is demanding definition, so it just doesn't keep bothering us. You know, I can't keep responding to it over and over and over. It's you know, the fool never learns. So I'm thinking of just putting a permanent block on it. Well, let us not say permanent. I'm just thinking about, for now, putting a block on it. Because all potential eternally exists for us, including the potential to act like fools. And so that's always a potential. We could not block it, but let us put a block on it for now. It's really like we have to do that now in order to be correctly informed. I mean, the mind is really desperately trying to defend defenses. It just won't quit. The mind won't quit. The mind doesn't get tired, actually. It's not like the mind runs out of energy. The actual mind, no. So it will continue to keep throwing all these tricks at us. And it's getting indeed it is getting to the point of a certain amount of frustration and agitation and feeling like so we're at that time now in April, we're going into April. It's getting more difficult. It's getting a lot more difficult as I shared that it would as we go forward. Now in the last 15-month period, before it gets maybe before we get blocked, as it were, we might end up feeling that we're blocked, so we better throw a block on that which is trying to throw a block on us, actually. And the block would just be that it can't interfere with no blockage. The block, it's blocked from throwing any blocks on us. You might say that. It's indescribable how messed up this mental scenario that we're following is. It's indescribably messed up, and we're not even going to try to describe it. What we're going to do is we're just going to abide in the non-dual awareness. That's all. And follow the Holy Spirit, follow the inherent wisdom of non-dual abidance as to what to say, where to go, what to do, all of that. And the other, of course, makes all these claims that in fairness and everything. Well, we'll leave fairness up to God, okay? We're not going to discuss the issue of fairness here. We'll let God sort that out. We're going to just do what we feel, what we see is right, and then let the chips fall wherever they may. Certainly, we cannot continue on any sort of appeasement path. It's simply out of control. It's like a wildfire is burning in this, just a massive wildfire. And in California we're very used to this, and we understand that a wildfire burning out of control, you don't sit and talk about it's an emergency. It is what it is. And you don't argue about definitions of it at that point. You understand what's going on. It's an out of control wildfire, and you better make sure you're not in its way. That's all there is to it. And of course, those who are using this issue of fairness are just going to continue using it and hook as many fish as they can with it. That's all. And like I said, we'll let God sort out fairness in the end here. We're not concerned about that right now. We're concerned about, getting out of the way of this wildfire. Better turn on our sprinkler system, We better saturate the house with water, as it were, so it can't catch fire. It's really time to turn on all the fire sprinklers and wet everything down and make sure that the house doesn't burn down. We're not going to sit around waiting for the fire department to tell us what we can and can't do. Let God sort that out in the end, okay? If that should ever be anything like that, which there will not. But it's time for us to be super saturated with the water of life right now, and take refuge in that. So the flames cannot touch us, cannot harm us. It's like having a cloud over your house raining. The rain just pouring down, and the wildfire can't get anything started. All the sparks are just extinguished before they can even get to your house. This is what we have to do. We have to take this action because there's drastic malfeasance taking place in the world right now. There's an incorporation of this world by a cosmic corporate culture, artificial intelligence. It's to the point now where the right steps have to be taken, And too bad that they don't like it. You know, let them complain to God about it, and we'll let God sort it out. Yeah, if they tell them, hey, you want to complain to God, go ahead, be my guest, please, please do so. And meanwhile, I'm going to take apply the appropriate remedy to keep my sanity intact. You know, and if God wants to rule against keeping my sanity intact, well, we'll face that music if it ever comes. I don't believe it will. So again, they're going to cry unfair. Great, let them cry. That's how. That's their tactic. It's unfair, 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 unfair. Which is meaningless to God, actually. It's, God never even would never even consider such a statement. We're perfectly free. There's no issue of fairness whatsoever in reality. So let them cry unfair, unfair, unfair. We're going to protect ourselves from being pulled into insanity. Their insanity. What they're doing is they're marketing insanity. As if this were some great adventure. Not only that, but some great transcendent adventure that will enable us to transcend reality. So we know this is all just a whimsical caprice. And we need to shift into this great nonchalance, this blissful nonchalance. I tried to use examples of this great nonchalance by using different teachers in the past, but right now, every time I try to, for instance, say maybe I'll do a video on Anandamayi, every single time I try to click on some of these videos and start working, maybe and doing something, the internet stops working. It just blocked. It's incredible. It's been going on and on and on like this. I cannot do it. So it's not meant to be. That's not meant to be. We have to do it ourselves. We have to do it ourselves. We can't just use a picture of a guru, you know, in the past to protect us or whatever. No, we have to actually do it ourselves. We have to be the ones that we look to now. Okay, we have to be the ones that we look to. We're told, at least the Christians are told, to put on the spiritual protection, to absolutely use spiritual protection. You have to. It's very important. And I think we've forgotten how to do this, actually. And it's really the same protection for everybody. It's not, doesn't belong to any particular religion or anyone. It's basic. You know, it's just like if there's a wildfire, you turn on the overhead sprinklers, you know, the house is just protected by a wall, you know, a massive amount of water, saturated with water. There's nothing, no sparks can get started at all. And of course, we can be sitting under a porch where we're not getting wet, you know, but around us, we're surrounded by this bubble of water that just totally protects us. Totally protects us, the water of spirit, the living waters. So we have to do that, and we have to be the ones. We have to be the ones. And the ego screaming, unfair, too bad, ego. Take it up with God. You know, cosmic corporate culture say, we're going to stop you. We're going to stop you. And they say, well, no, you're not. And they say, well, that's unfair. That's unfair. That's unfair. Really? You're going to stop me from accepting sanity? And you claim not being able to do that is unfair? Unfair to what? There isn't any second God. So there's not a God of insanity. So how can you be unfair? Being unfair about nothing to be unfair to. We're all one in the one God. And we cannot be unfair to the one God. We're perfectly free. So saying I'm unfair is ridiculous. So don't buy into this unfairness thing. And they're going to say, well, we're going to shut ourselves off from you for forever and ever. We're never going to go. You're going to be separate. You're separating yourself from us by taking this stance. You're going to be eternally separate from us. And I say, well, we'll see about that. We'll see who has the last laugh on that. Don't fall for that. They try to threaten you with that for sure. Nobody can ever be separate from the oneness. There isn't any separation, no matter what anyone says or threatens. It's impossible. So it's just an empty threat, total empty threat. And if they say, well, you're protecting yourself and we're not, that's not one. Well, they can protect themselves too from insanity. And if they choose not to, that's their choice. It doesn't separate them. It doesn't mean I have to follow that choice to try to abide in insanity. You can't find any abidance in insanity, actually. You're just restless. There's no abidance there. You can feel the restlessness in the world, can't you? Good grief. I'm not in the best of moods. I've got to be careful what I say because, things have just become outrageous here. Just absolutely outrageous in the world. We're not going to talk about them. We're going to protect ourselves from it. Talk about how great it is to be protected from it. And our protection from insanity is sanity. So we abide in insanity, which is indescribable. Nothing can be said about sanity. There's absolutely nothing that can ever be said about sanity. This is an assertion we can use. I abide in that about which nothing can ever be said. And they say, well, we need to attack it, so you need to say something so we can attack it. We can't attack nothing that can be said about it. We can't attack that. I say, well, that's too bad. If you want to call it unfair, go ahead. But this will always be the case. There'll never be anything you can say about it. You can't even say it's unfair. Can't say anything about it. So yes, indeed, we are up against the situation now. We're really up against it. And I feel like something has to be done. I feel like when the baseball season started, I felt, well, let me start paying attention to baseball. But no, I got this feeling like really nervous and jittery and feeling like, no, that's wrong, that's wrong. We can't waste any time. We cannot just go on business as usual in this world here now. This is a serious situation. I want to do something to be helpful. So something has got to, we got to get going here big time. And again, we can't just keep settling for those in the past who have been here in the past. We have to be do it ourselves here. We have to do it ourselves right now. Just have to totally shut out the ego and its voice. You know, just block the ego's voice. Put a block on it. It's like on a website, put a block. You know, on the ego, and it just cannot say anything anymore, cannot interfere, cannot say anything. Now we think, oh, well, then we wouldn't know if we're being fair or not. Well, again, fairness, we'll let God sort that out. We know really that there's no issue of fairness at all in reality, so we'll say, we'll just let God sort it all out, what's fair and what's not fair. We don't need to pay any attention to what the ego, its claims and all that stuff, counterclaims. It's ridiculous. It's wasted enough of our time. And when we realize that all defenses are equally won in flimsiness, that death is no more important a defense as any other defense. They're all equally ridiculously futile and transparent. So there's nothing, no order or difficulty at all to address, actually. And so what is there to address anymore? There's nothing really to address in terms of the ego. The ego is all about order of difficulty. There isn't any order of difficulty. So there's really nothing more to say to the ego. And the ego says, well, that's not fair. I need you to help. We need to determine the order of difficulty. There isn't any order of difficulty. All defenses, God's not chasing us. There is no flaw in God. Nothing has happened. So there are no defenses. There's nothing to defend against. So there can't be any order of difficulty in defenses, actually. And therefore, there's nothing more to say to the ego. That's the ego's whole thing, is defending us and needing advice. And it thinks that we're an advisor to it, you know. And no, there's nothing to say, nothing to advise the ego about, actually. So there's no more reason to have any more conversation with the ego, or, you know, it's time to feel that's passé now. The ego's passé, and we're no longer interacting with it. And we're not losing any advice. As long as we think the ego has something to advise us about, we'll listen. But there isn't any advice it can give us. It only talks about defenses, actually. The ego only is interested in defending ourselves against God. And we can't defend ourselves because God isn't putting up any sort of threat to us whatsoever. So how can you say there's a defense if there's absolutely no threat whatsoever? The whole meaning of defensiveness is ridiculous. And then all defensiveness is equally ridiculous, equally meaningless, actually. So time to say goodbye to the ego. Again, the ego wants some definition so it can you know, call that a threat. But there's no definition that can ever be applied to reality whatsoever. So the ego thinks it's facing some completely indeterminate threat. It has no idea how to defend against it and says, that's not fair. I have to defend. No, the ego doesn't have to defend. There's nothing to defend against. It doesn't have to defend. There's nothing to defend against. So it's ridiculous to say, I have to defend. Well, of course, as long as we keep this idea of wanting to find a flaw in God, the ego has to defend our desire to pursue that nonsense. So we can't really blame the ego because it only arises out of our desire to be greater than God and find a flaw in reality, and then it defends the search. It defends the search. And claims, of course, that God is trying to prevent us from finding this, and therefore we have to protect ourselves from God because God is trying to destroy us before we find the flaw, because we say that once we find the flaw, we'll know that we're greater than God, and God doesn't want us to discover this. You know, this is all completely invented. There's not a grain of truth to any of that. So just keep hearing this, keep hearing it, and I know that the listeners are, you know, it's takes a little while to settle in, but at some point you'll be familiar with it, and you'll say, oh yeah, I see that. You'll just click, and you say, oh my gosh, I see that now, and you'll say, oh, that's not difficult. It was just my continuity fear that was making it seem difficult, but it's not really difficult at all. None of this is difficult. It's only continuity fear. That's why the continuity fear problem is the only problem we have. We don't have any other problem. Once the continuity fear evaporates, then it's very simple and easy to see. It's just like, oh, of course. Why did I ever think that was the slightest bit difficult? So that's how it is. Got some rain here last night. It's cold right now. Actually snowed up on the mountaintops a little bit, they say. Hailed. hailed here for a little bit. It's clearing out, and in a few days it'll be nice, sunny, and warming up again. Not enough rain to do much more than just keep the greenery alive, I would say. So, this blockage of the ego is something that has to be done, and we have to recognize why we're doing it, because the ego doesn't have anything to say to us anymore. It's just wasting our time, completely wasting our time. There's no point in even listening to anything it says, because all it talks about is defenses, and we know there aren't any defenses against God, because none are needed. And a defense system that has no order of difficulty whatsoever and is defending against no threat whatsoever is simply set down like a feather, you know. There's no heaviness to setting it down at all. There's no trouble to that whatsoever. So we don't need to consult the ego on how to set the defenses down at all. It has nothing to say. It will only make it seem more difficult than it really is. All the ego can do... It's a skunk smell. All the ego can do is make it seem more difficult than it really is. Wow. I don't want a skunk wandering around here, that's for sure. I've had that happen to me once before. That was no fun. Oh, gosh. They can't see. They can walk right in, bump right into you, and not even see you. And they go, what the heck are you doing here? You know, it's like the way the ego is, right? It can't see at all. It bumps into you and blames you. It's blind and bumps into you and says, I gotta spray you. You're terrible. How could that, you know? So the ego can only make it more difficult than it actually is. That's all the ego can do. The ego can never make it easier, nor can it let it just be as easy as it is. Never. It will always make it seem more difficult than it actually is. So what kind of friend is the ego to us, actually? What kind of friend is it that always makes it more difficult for us? How's that a friend? As a friend to insanity. And of course, saying that God has a flaw is certainly insanity. So again, we don't fight the ego, don't blame it. It's just a spokesperson for insanity, essentially, is what it is. It's the spokesperson for our whim, is what it is. It's the spokes voice for our whim. But we want to set that whim down, so we're certainly... You know, the ego will always make it seem more difficult to set that whim down than it actually is. It's actually no trouble whatsoever. The ego will insist that it's very troublesome. And we can't do it yet. Can't do it now. We'll never, never agree to do it. It'll always say, no, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. Always. Okay. Yeah, it's cold outside. So, paying attention to the world right now gets me feel very tense and jittery and not good at all. I can tell when my mind is not going the right direction. I feel this like, you know, wow, I shouldn't be doing that. So, we certainly have to find the right groove right now. And this is the mandate that we have, is to find the right groove. And I'm not going to be finding it by getting into paying attention to the world. I don't know what the right groove is exactly, but we're going to find it. Now, the ego will tell us, well, if we protect ourselves from the ego, we can't help others, because the ego claims that it's the advisor to everyone, and the only way to help anyone is to advise the ego, you know, on what it could do better. But ultimately, the ego has the final say. Well, this is ridiculous, of course, because I said the ego can only make it seem more difficult than it really is. So how is that helping anyone? It's not helping anyone. So we don't have to advise the ego about how to not listen to the ego. Not at all. We just have to do it and then let others see our example. Lead by example. Lead by example. If you want to lead, you have to lead by example. Or if you want to help, you have to help by example. So we have to open our minds to what is it are we going to do now? I'm not sure. I don't know. First test is I don't know. And so we open our mind. I don't know means I need to know. I need to know what to do. God, show me what I need to do. Show me what I need to do. Let's. But again, seeing clearly the situation is, I would say, imperative of the kind of leverage the ego tries to use upon us. Of course, it tells us it's trying to make it easier to defend against God, is what it's saying. And we're saying that there isn't any defense against God. We just have to set it down. It's meaningless. So we're only interested in the ease of setting it down, not in trying to make it seem like a bad idea to set it down. No, it's a great idea, and it's easy. And the ego always says, well, you know, well, you're going to pay for it in the end. I say, well, what end? There's no end to reality. There's never any end. So they're not going to pay for it at all. Pay for it in the end. There's no end. Freedom is endless. You never pay for your freedom. And the ego says, well, you're making it more difficult for others. No, there's no difficulty at all in putting the defenses down. You have to just see it in the right perspective, and you say, oh, I see. Everything is like a feather. You know, it's all equally light. So again, ego, just bad advice, bad threats, bad everything. Mistaken, wrong. But I can definitely feel that there's some, we need to sync up with truth at this point in the world. It feels now as if the world is spinning away from truth now very decisively and rapidly. Spinning into defending defensiveness. And so we simply cannot go along with that. And so we're sort of feeling like in limbo here. But we have the tools and we have the clarity to settle down, that's for sure. Order. Again, defenses are all about order of difficulty. In order to make it seem possible that we could defend against God, we have to have order of difficulty. So when we see no order of difficulty, when our minds are all just one and abiding, the ego can't stand that. It cannot stand that. Because again, the ego stands for defensiveness. Period. That's it. So the ego has to ask questions, you know, ask you questions about, well, what is it? What is it that, you know, how are you successfully defending? It wants to know, essentially. And you say, there's nothing to defend against. It says, no. It says, no, I mean, you've got to be defending against something. The ego only understands defensiveness. It's born. It's a child of defensiveness. It's the defensiveness that we are using to believe that our misadventure is possible. You know, that's what it is. It's a child of defensiveness. That's what it is. It cannot understand no defensiveness. It cannot understand it. And in its understanding, it's striving to understand, it insists upon, you know, levels. Even just if it's a simple level of good and bad, you know, at least that's a level. It can understand. I'm defending against something. So the ego has to feel that it's defending against something. Otherwise, it feels it doesn't exist. And of course, it doesn't really exist. What is meaningless doesn't exist. The skunk smell seems to have vanished. That's great. So we're getting there. We're getting there, but we need to get there, actually. In fact, we need to insist that we are here. And where is here? There's absolutely nothing, no way to define here whatsoever. It's impossible to define here-ness. There's nothing that can ever be said about here-ness. There's nothing that can ever be said about non-dual abidance, actually. There's no definition that can ever be applied whatsoever. And therefore, the ego needs a definition to defend against. So it's just, you know, the ego's freaking out. The ego says, I'm terrified. I feel like I don't have any defenses. I don't, you know, don't need them. So we've been stringing this out and stringing it out and stringing it out. This is what the ego is good at, and we're trying to bring that to an end. And we're certainly chipping away at it. That is for sure. But I do advise practicing that repetition of I am not a body, I am free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me, and practice saying that and saying it over and over and over and over for as long as you can, and just don't judge whatever arrives, don't judge it. All defensiveness is equally meaningless, okay? So there's nothing to judge, don't need to judge, just keep stating the truth over and over and over and over and over. And we need to be the examples that we're looking for here at this time. We absolutely must be the examples we're looking for. So I'm not sure. Some of the dreams I have, you can have two different explanations going one way or the other. And then it's difficult to determine. I try to put a positive spin on them. So it's not always easy to determine this, but again, that meditation of I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I feel this is the certain, you can't go wrong if you do that. If you want to know a way that you just can't go wrong, is you keep asserting this. Just go right back to and focus on it and try to be assertive with it. And this really, 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 this is the snowplow. And plows everything out of the way. Can't go wrong with you. Just keep asserting the truth. Keep asserting the truth. Keep asserting the truth. And just that's all you're doing. I'm just doing that. And don't try to defend it. Don't defend it. See, that's what the ego tries to get you to defend it. Because as soon as you start defending, then the ego's got you. But you're not defending it at all. You just keep saying it. The ego says, why are you doing this? Don't answer. You just keep saying it. Or I might say, oh, that's great. Can you explain, you know, how it's helping? Don't explain anything. That too is often a defense, really. Just keep saying it. And this will certainly stabilize you and make you feel you're in charge, actually. You're in charge. So these times are, you know, I would say the most difficult times we're in right now. So we need to pull out all the stops. So there isn't any down the road. There isn't any end. There isn't any layers or levels or any of that. There's no defenses at all against God, because God cannot threaten in any way, and we're perfectly free. What needs a defense? Nothing needs a defense. Defenses are impossible. That which is perfectly free can never be said to have a defense. It's impossible. Every moment is fresh and freshly liberated from all other moments. How can we say we have a defense? How can we say there's layers and levels and degrees and all this? It's ridiculous. It doesn't exist. Except in our belief system. So we certainly do need a turnaround, no question about it. Now, I don't want to tape too much, I know, but on the other hand, I don't want to under-tape either. I don't want to spend time looking at, diversions in the world. It's, you know, we don't have time for that anymore. We need to really be getting after it, seriously getting after it. You know, we just can't keep pretending like we have all the time in the world to, or conversely, we can't keep pretending like we're under pressure. You know, we have to literally realize we're not under any pressure at all, zero. Otherwise, we're certainly going to get pushed around by the pressure. Imagine pressure, absolutely. We will. So we have to realize there's no pressure at all. Zero. Zero pressure. And of course the ego is the one who believes in applying pressure. And to say there's no pressure at all, you know, the ego says, well, you can't say that. I say, well, sure we can, because that's the truth. Denying the truth is not some identity. We don't have an identity that's based on denying the truth. We just have a restlessness. Restlessness is not identity. So, all empowerment to everyone. All empowerment to everyone always here is what we aim for. All empowerment to everyone always. Anyone in the world is free to watch these videos, okay? Not discriminating at all. The ego only discriminates. What does it do? It discriminates against the truth. All right? That's what the ego does. The ego is an inherent discriminator. However it tries to play it, that's all that it does, is it discriminates against the truth. And so what we have to realize is there's no discrimination at all taking place. So there isn't any ego, right? Everything's perfect. Everything's flawless. Freedom is flawless right now. Our freedom is totally flawless right now. It's like that tooth we had when we were kids, and a tooth is coming out, and there's still something holding on to it. There's something, and finally it drops away. We just have to keep our patience, keep practicing, and it should just click. It should just click for us. I mean, it should just okay. There's nothing that I need to get. There's nothing that I need to define. Nothing I need to succeed at. There's no pressure. There's no problem. There's, you know, in other words, the ego's pressuring us into believing that there's pressure. And we have to recognize there isn't any pressure at all. So ultimately the ego tries to goad us into getting rid of the ego. And what we really need to do is just abide in the realization there isn't any ego. There's never been. So how can the ego claim that you're getting rid of me? No, what we need to see fundamentally is that there's never been any ego. There's never been an ego. So how can we be worried about getting rid of an ego? It's never been there. It's never existed. So we're making our way, you know, just stumbling along best we can. Now, were we crazy to believe in an ego? No, because that belief system was simply necessary in order to entertain the idea of trying to be greater than God, and therefore trying to find a flaw in God. It was simply necessary. There's no way we can entertain that idea without it. So we weren't crazy. We haven't been crazy, actually, at all. We simply took a whimsical idea, and from that standpoint, then, we've not been crazy. We've just been doing what we had to do to entertain this idea, that's all. And we don't want to entertain the idea anymore, then we don't need to keep doing this, keep believing that there ever was an ego. You know, never was. Never were any defenses. Never was any pressure. So it's great to say all this and get used to it. It's helpful, but we still need to be the ones that realize this right now. We need to be the ones. Of course, what never existed can't ever come back, can it? We don't have to worry about the ego coming back. Once you see it's never existed, how can we ever fall down again? There's nowhere to fall to. It just doesn't seem like the internet is where it's at anymore, really. You can feel like technology no longer seems like where it's at. This is the feeling that I have. It's like, oh wow. It's already passé. And those who are not going towards enlightenment are just going to just keep getting in their own way more and more and more and more and more. And that's no fun. That's no fun. If you've been there and done that, that is not where we want to go. So we need to be the ones that highlight the truth, and everyone who can needs to pay attention and just decide, you know, that's the next big thing. Is paying attention to truth is the next big thing. And we just realize that technology is no longer the next big thing. It doesn't matter what kind of tweaks they do to it, you know, it doesn't matter anymore. It's no longer the next big thing. I just drove by the Apple, new Apple camp headquarters. They're building the spaceship. They're building. You know, you could see how high it's going to be. You know, and it's like, wow. And it's a massive construction project. And I realized. I looked at it. And I just said, wow. That's so passé, isn't it? It's so passé. The whole thing is over with, and so there isn't any next big thing in technology. Actually, we're barking up the wrong tree. They're all barking up the wrong tree. The next big thing is spiritual realization. Actually, that's where it's at now. And, you know, there are those of us who see it and realize that, wow, yeah, just driving by the new Apple complex that's going up, I realize it might as well be 1984 or something or whatever. I mean, that's no longer it. I don't care what kind of buildings you build. It just isn't it anymore. And all you're doing is just tweaking stuff, you know. Just that we've been there, we've done that, and it's finished. It's finished. It no longer captures our attention, actually. And we're already becoming rapidly bored with it. Very rapidly bored with it. And, of course, they're desperately trying to get artificial intelligence to bully us into thinking that being bored with it is where it's at. And no, it isn't. We're really bored. Technology is very boring at this point. And no glittering spaceship Apple headquarters is going to change that one iota, actually. You see all the building, the construction workers, and you know everything is happening, and in the big cement works, and numerous cement works there, and cranes, and it's just construction. It's just construction. Knowing what goes on, it's just same old, same old, same old. You know, we've always been building. You know, buildings, Parthenon, you know, the Temple of Jupiter, and where is it? Baalbek, right? We've always been building, trying to build something very impressive. It's always passé. Building itself is passé, actually. Very much so. Materialism is passé. Construction, manufacturing, is just tweaking now. I mean, the intrigue is gone, the thrill is gone, and it will never come back for us. It will never come back. There's no way to recapture that. So, what's left? Realization is what is left for us. That's what's left for us. Maybe I should get a picket sign or sign and just hold it up in front of the new Apple headquarters they're constructing and say, Apple is dead, you know, instead of God is dead. Apple is dead, or technology is dead. That's the truth. You want something that resonates. Technology is dead. That's the truth, isn't it? Technology is dead. That might tick off the senators from California, who, of course, have to be very boosterish about the economy here. And they say, no, technology is the thing. It will always be the thing. No, it isn't, dear senators. Technology is dead. It's as dead as a doornail. Dead and buried, actually. And we've already moved on from it. Really. People feel it within themselves. They realize, wow, this isn't it. You know, it just really isn't it. I was looking for getting a new HD TV. Ours is completely, it's tiny and it's going bad, all fuzzy and lines, it's just terrible. And then I realized, you know, I was looking, researching, I said, none of this is it anymore. I don't care how big, or it's a curved screen, Samsung's new curved screen, ultra thin, bright and stuff. Nah, that's not it, it's dead. It's boring. That's not the next big thing, ever. No, it's not. And I just said, what's the use? Who cares? Who really cares? This is ridiculous. What are we, idiots, artificial and robot, intelligence robots or something? Just repeating the programs that have been programmed into us? This is nonsense. Technology is dead. Long live God. Really, technology is dead. Long live God. Technology is dead. God is eternal. There you go. Technology is dead. God is eternal. Hold up the sign at the new Apple headquarters. See how long it takes before the gendarmes arrest you. Straight from the senator's office. We can't have that. They'll call the senator a senator. What do we do? What do we do? Is there some law against this? Yeah. Just we'll make up a law. Don't worry. Just arrest them and we'll deal with it. Talk to the Attorney General of California. I'm sure they'll figure up some charges undermining the economy, you know. Yeah, technology is dead. Life is eternal. God is eternal. Technology is dead. God is eternal. Maybe we should start picketing the Apple building. Just getting people to walk around the whole perimeter of it with signs. Technology is dead. God is eternal. Yeah, why not? They picket all sorts of stuff, right? Don't the activists picket everything? And they're allowed to do that, of course. But you just wait. You try to picket the new Apple construction. They probably end up being taken up in some spaceship. Turned into Soylent Green. Can't have that, right? You can't say that technology, you can't speak the truth here. The Empress has no clothes, you know. Or the Empress is wearing a sackcloth. Or it doesn't really matter. We don't really care what the Empress is wearing, actually. It's all boring. Whatever she's wearing is boring. Don't really care at all. Fashion is dead. God is eternal. Technology is dead. God is eternal. This is the truth. That'd be interesting. I have no desire to get myself arrested. But I'm telling you, if you want to kick up a firestorm, just hold up a sign on one of those major roads there. Technology is dead. God is eternal. And, I mean, you would just, you know, you're going to start a night of firestorm. You're going to be whisked off into some mental institution. Never seen again. You'll never be seen again, probably. Literally, I bet you. I don't, you know, you'd need like a, you know, have a bus in 1,000 people that make it's hard to make them all disappear. You know, tell the press to be there too, but you'd quickly disappear anyway, one by one. I am quite sure that those folks will not brook any such truth. They cannot tolerate the truth like that. They're heavily invested into boredom, right? Apple stock, you know, can't have Apple stock go down. Really, seriously. I mean, they smile and they seem nice, but you really think they want their Apple stock to go down? Technology is dead, God is eternal. No way, no way. They will protect their investments at all costs. Just like Jesus came into the world, we think, oh, everyone's going to welcome Jesus with open arms. No way. You don't think that the Sadducees are going to defend their temple sacrifices and the massive income they get from that and et cetera, et cetera? Of course, and their position in society, the self-righteousness and the Sanhedrin. You don't think that, of course, are they kidding? They're going to say, hey, we can't have Jesus coming in here and saying that God doesn't require any sacrifice. As a matter of fact, we'll turn the tables on Jesus and make him the ultimate sacrifice. And say that God does demand a sacrifice, or that we have given that sacrifice, and we can make money off that forever. It's a money-making thing. It's a power thing. Sacrifice is always a money-making power scheme. And so... yeah, they didn't like Jesus at all. Technology's dead. God is eternal. Wake up. This is already the truth. Or maybe we can just like staple leaflets everywhere. I wonder how long they would stay up. Then there'd be a witch hunt for whoever put those posters up or something. Guarantee you. Are you kidding? No, nobody does a thing. And they're raising this grand, greatest church in the world to technology. And everybody just goes on as if nothing is happening at all. There's no thought whatsoever about it other than, well, yeah, as soon as it's ready, we're ready to worship. But it's amazing. It's absolutely amazing that this ultimate citadel to technology, this new Apple headquarters, is simply nobody is saying a word about it in context, actually. Truly astonishing, huh? That's a sign of just how far we've fallen. Are you kidding me? I mean, there's no activism at all about that. None. Zero. No people opening the eyes saying, hey, we don't need this church. We're not going to attend this church. Technology's dead. You're worshiping a dead idol. Totally dead idol. Only God is alive. God is eternal life. Right now. I tell you, I mean, the tech people will be no less ring, you know, they're the new Sadducees, you know, Pharisees, Sadducees, they're the new Sanhedrin, they're the modern Sanhedrin. I mean, right? How dare anybody, you know, speak, not follow, not worship in their temple, not do the things that they tell you to do, etc., etc. How dare there be a Jesus, you know, in the world? They forbid it. It's forbidden. Totally forbidden. Maybe you have someone in sandals and white robe standing outside the headquarters saying, you know, technology is dead. Repent, repent, repent. Technology is dead. God is eternal. Yeah, plenty of billionaires in this area wouldn't particularly appreciate that. That's about as welcome here right now as Jesus disturbing the sacrifices, or you know, breaking the rules of the Sabbath, and et cetera, et cetera. That's about how welcome it would be here. They'd say, seize him, seize him, seize him. Kill him, stone him. You know, we can't have that. It's heresy, heresy to our ever increasing flow of money that we're extorting from everyone, claiming that this is where it's at. Just like the sacrificers told every population, you know, God's going to smite you dead if you don't come sacrifice here at the temple and pay all the fees and all that stuff, you know. So you're going to be struck dead for being, for not following his rule and law here. And of course, Jesus didn't pay attention to that. And they said, oh my God, the people are going to follow Jesus and not us. And what's going to happen to our power and influence? Oh my gosh, we can't have that. Wow, we'll see. We'll see what happens now. This is just like, wow. But certainly, we cannot just keep drifting and drifting and drifting. And we have to, you know, enough's enough in terms of being stupid, playing stupid, and we just have to. Free ourselves from the egoic insanity, and be enlightened, have divine nonchalance. Look right past the world, all the sacrificial worship of the world. See the sameness of everything, see the sameness of all, and do not be. No longer even pay lip service to, you know, the notion that technology should be worshipped. Technology's dead. It's absolutely dead. We're not dead. Technology's dead. So let's make that plain. It's technology that's dead. We live. We're alive. We live, actually. We live in truth and spirit. And it's artificial intelligence that's dead. It's dead from the very beginning. So we'll see what Jesus does next. We'll see what happens next altogether. I'm not an activist, so I don't plan on doing anything in particular in that regard at all. I might say I'm a spiritual. No, I'm not an activist. I'm just. But we have to, so we'll just see what comes to mind. Just enlightenment. But it's good to just, you know, keep our awareness, keep washing away the dirt that blinds us, and open our eyes and realize what's going on, and how we've just come to accept, you know, this takeover by death, the death of technology. It's not a lie. It doesn't lead to life. It doesn't. It's trying to just glamorize death, actually. So repent, repent, repent. Technology is dead. God is eternal. All right, and so I don't know what's next. I absolutely don't know. My mind is like just an open, completely open to, you know, what is next, and I'll find out and share it. Very great. That's it for this one.